They program me to be wild. Somebody take a channel and pull it up with one man. Next thing I know, I hear a splash all over. Vibration was really weird. Panorama in my head. This began a potent musical alignment of two music heaven and well. That's why I'm
Vanish the jumping. Vanish the jumping.
It's in fan, they bless me.
As soon as a fan play, they simply slap well. Like a marie bone, my skin starts to red. Vanish the jumping.
Stop them.
I can't believe
you're
the same thing.
I've been talking about the story of the festival and how it goes on all sides of the competition.
She win. When? Because there's dreaming, yes?
So, Taro, all the women about the festival, and
yeah, it's not just, the film is not just about the festival, you know. It's about, you know, people, the people who really start the Steelband movement, right? Who struggle for it, who push it forward, you know? It's about the instrument. You see them nice instruments that will be played in the festival and thing? But where they really come from the old long-time instruments, the old, you know, tenor kettle and all them old to the punting that used to be sung in bar and making noise long time to these refined instruments, right? All of that, the people who bring it there, the whole evolution of the Steelband, that is what we're dealing with.
The history of the Steelband is long overdue. There are so many persons who contributed, known and unknown, and those who have passed beyond. And this is a very, very, very good. For it must be known that the Steelband was originated in Trinidad, developed by Trinidadians, young Trinidadians and fellows, you may say, who hadn't something to eat, nothing to somewhere to sleep. And they have given us instrument, this influence of the 20th century from the world, and we must be recognized, we must be known that it's ours. I still remember, you know, these fellows coming down with this big bamboo and their music, bukuduku, and they're coming down the road, bottle and spoon. But I know a old tune that I used to hear them sing as a little boy coming down. Pam party peeling ping 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 pam 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 ping 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 ping. A lot of rhythm, plenty of rhythm, and part of that rhythm pass over to the Steelband.
A little before the bamboo, they used to have iron and drums on the streets.
The greater part of the Steelbands came from areas where you had this Orisha or Rada, or where the African religion was practiced, where you had the drums and the sticks and so on.
When I first went to the Panya, my first experience, it just took me back to Africa. Because the pan, I mean, the music of the pan, it's another, you know, I hear a lot of similarities in the music of balafone in Africa, the music of mbira. You know, you have a lot of different traditional African instruments.
But even in the iron, with the steel that you play, is part of the original instruments that is used. Because I asked a question, I went to a feast, what they call an ebo. Or something like that, the religious ceremony, and I saw this fellow chime a ho. So I asked the question, what is it all about? And he told me it's a welcome song. It is chiming for an entity or what they call a power. A certain power, they have to chime this piece of steel. So I got an idea where the steel came from, along with the drum.
And I spent a lot of time in West Africa and East Africa and North, and I see kind of like this universal movement of music. I saw a lot of similarities in the spiritual evocation of the music from the pan.
The Steelband in itself, we have to see, they inherit a sort of a stigma. The stick fighter, the drums, this is very important again, because the stick fighter who fought all about in various years that they had in Port of Spain, they used the drums. And it's the same sort of people that come into this with the bamboo and with the steel band. So when people see this, you with this, you are Kaladiwa, you are Bajon, you know, all kind of names. Long before there were actually a steel band on the streets, I saw and heard pan beatings on the streets during Carnival period. The people who were most famous for that was in Knockabout All About Sailors. Carnival day, they knock two pans and knock the pans, they would pour water and they make a joyful noise and dance and sing on the street. That was even before the time of what we call Fancy Sailor. Or it evolved from the Knockabout to the what you call Fancy Sailor, which was in the 30s, and then eventually what you call the King Sailor. So the pan as I know it, or the steel band, which I rather just say the steel band, at the period when it came in, it sort of married with the bamboo. So bamboo and the steel band play together. And eventually, the pan fills out the bamboo. The first pan that you were able to distinguish was the pan that carried over from the drums, which we call a beast. The West eventually called it a dudu. It's from the same rhythm of the drum. That was the driving force of the steel band in that period. Well, eventually, they named that pan a kittle. They had the bass kittle, and then you had the kittle. Well, the kittle was the first instrument from which they were able to play any kind of melody. But the coming of World War II, in 1941 or 42, they said, they drove them off the streets. When they chased the fellows off the streets, they didn't sort of put down the instruments. They went about innovating and inventing. But V-Day, when they declared, well, war ceased, then the fellows came on the road with an instrument like this. So this is what you call the mother pan. We call it a ping pong. So this is the mother ping. This is the mother ping pong of the 55-gallon drum that you have today. Between this and the 55-gallon drum, this is the intermediate pan that came about. Then came the early manet period. When early manet brought about a new idea, and he reversed the procedure and grew the pans as you know them today.
So Taro, this film is only about the pioneers and the history, Steven.
We're not only dealing with the history, we're dealing with the instrument especially, because the persons who make the instrument, the tuners, are some of the most important people in the steel band movement.
You have persons who are innovators, inventors, structurers, builders, tuners of the instrument. Then they go so far to be good players. They are the early pioneers. Those are the persons like Neville Jones, Early Manet, Anthony Williams, and in recent time people as Booty Marshall and the great deceased, the Doll Charles.
Oh, love until here we come. Love until here we come. We come. We're singing praises to your son, for love until here we come.
Let me start the walk.
Somewhere up in Lavanti, many years ago, used to follow him to and fro.
What he used to do?
He used to use it up.
Well, you had to first see like a drum that is hooked up, sink in it, that big sledge. Then you draft out your notes. When you draft out your notes, then you had to groove it. Mohammed, you know, beat it back, and then you groove it. Then all of this, you cut it according to length. And then you fire it up a little bit, you put it on a little fire, you burn it, and you pre-tune it, get ready for combing.
When I was really born in St. Vincent Street, when I was a little boy, my mother and my father moved to John John. And it's just had a 16 band from them as a little boy. talking about 6-7 years old. Older they are, like, essentially busy school, I just spray on them. You know what I mean, doing the thing. And I hear the melodies start to come into the piano thing, and I used to play motor organ and thing. So I run away and used to go below a house to learn to beat pan, because my mother didn't like steel band at all. She wanted me to be a doctor.
I started working on a small biscuit tin as if it was pan. I put four notes and made it into, and played Mary Had a Little Lamb. The Americans had a bass drum and Mokura Pond. They had a bundle of all the drums scattered there, dumped there. So I got one day a roller put on the drum and I started to work on the other drum.
And then I want a tune too, so I go up in, you know, in the bush in them days, in back of Levante, they have, you know, a lot of little ravine and bush up in there. We light up, we fire and drum in Japan. We doing best over see spree and them do not, in Gambia. At time we tried to burn a pan below the house. And in those, the house I talking about was about 2 feet off the ground, you know, a low house. So we get in below there and we light the fire. 2 or 3 feet above that, yeah. And we light a fire and the fire get out of control because below the house have a lot of rubbish. But you talk about legs.
The Spider-Man came out in 1952. It's designed in Fort Sanchez. That is, was C, F, C, D, E, F. I drew some straight lines from the center to the outside of the pan, to the edge of the drum, and made some straight lines crossing, and it appeared to be a spider web. And somebody said it looked like a spider web, called it spider web, and so it got its name, spider web pan.
First thing happened, we get an old pan from Tokyo, and I'm trying to tune it over. And so from that age, that young age, I started really, because it's a pretty harmonica. And harmonica helped me in later days, because when I discovered harmonics, which is a new order, the order they use today in tuning pan, it's really harmonica, by hand the overtones. And I started to experiment. I experimented for a long while. And then about in 1956, I started to get the harmonics, because I experimented for a while, you know. And I started to get the harmonics. And from there, Silver Stars and most of the bands come around me to tune the pans and things. But in those days, you know, they had no money and things.
After that, I started working on pan and stands, the second pan. I put them on, I made a wooden stand for it and hang it on the stand, because it was, it sounded better when it was hanging. I noticed when it rests on a leg, it kills some of the reverberation. I wanted to use the chromatic bass on the road. So we couldn't put the pan around the neck on the road, because we had to get the bass, and the bass contained 3 drums at the time. So we couldn't carry 3 oil drums around the neck. So we had to put it on wheels, so I put pan on wheels in 1956.
Entertaining the Americans on Chagarangas. We used to play down there 2 or 3 nights a week. But then around 56, when Eric Williams and them come and put up power, and they decided to take over the base now. Okay. They say, well, the base is over. The entertainments had a cut down there, and I was forced to come and reorganize my band for parties on the outside, like, you know, organize a bigger band. Because we used to use about 8 men down there. Money was small, but it was a share. But the change started happening when they organized more competition, and then they started opening things like association, and then fellas experimenting, you know, and well, the place getting more enlightened, and just so the steel band was progressing, because the steel band started to play a lot of great music. Before they even had instrument was probably tuned. You know what I mean, Griffith, Griffith and them when they went to task school days. Pan just song we find out of. But they know they had something. Just around that time too. Pan used to get a lot of parties. Sometimes they have 3 steel band, 1 music.
The task made a great effect on the steel band. It introduced the chromatic steel band. Prior to that, only the ping pong was tuned to the chromatic scale. But Griffith wanted a chromatic steel band. Joseph Griffith was the musical director. So he introduced the chromatic tenor bomb, the bass, and the double second, and the alto pong. So that was how Taspo came to be a popular steel band. And they were able to play almost any type of music on the pans with the chromatic steel band. In 1951, Taspo went to Britain to perform at the Festival of Britain. And there they played on television and at the Savoy Hotel and as a Mecca dance hall, a chain of dance hall called the Mecca dance halls. And then they went to Paris and played at the Medrano Circus.
They're always trying to introduce a wider range of bands and until I end up lazy amplifying. You know, trying to cut down the size of the steel band because I find it economically it was not profitable. But the best thing was the late half when I get on to trying to elongate the notes. You know, like you hit a note and you could between the thing and the key, the evolution of the key, it could linger instead of you had to roll. You could roll too if you want, but I feel that you know, a continuous song, when you strike it, a continuous song. But then you had to control that, you know. So there's where a mechanical part had to come in and thing. I was on a good thing and then I had a disastrous fire, they burned everything. So I never go back into that. Then in 90 centers had a hook on Rudolph. Damn the sparrows. Tuning for them for about 22 years, you know. And he like experiments too. So both of them meet up. And then we bring all this quadrophonic, you know, martial tunes, anything. He consulted me because, you know, I have more experience in the tuning than him. But he have ideas and we used to work together. I miss him a lot for that.
Say we got to find the hammer.
Yeah, Mr. Batson, what do you think about the festival today to the festival of the early years?
In the earlier period, we hadn't, there was no festival, just competitions. And today, what I have seen and heard is beyond my imagination. I never thought that I'd be able to see such instrument and hear such instrument as we have today and the music that that comes out from the instruments of the steel bands. It is beyond my imagination.
Steel band men have a tremendous capacity that I think is really safely could be unparalleled anywhere else, because to retain 200 to 300 bars of music is not an easy feat for somebody to do, and here it is that these guys are doing it. When I look at the Boston Symphony Orchestra or the New York Philharmonic, you find that the conductor would be the one that really memorizes a score, and you know the other guys, you know, the violinists are reading, the trumpeters are reading, they've got to count bar rest and all that kind of stuff. With the steel band men, it's pure retention, and I think it's a great skill that they have. In addition to which, the people that day in and day out go into the panyards and work with these scores I'm talking about the conductors, you know, the Gemmets, the Prospects, the Pat Bishops, you know, all those people, the Villafanas, they have a tremendous amount of patience.
Evolution and all these things is nice, you know, but what about standardizing the pan to make sure that you know, it stays here?
You made a very valid point there about standardization. That is going to be one of the segments on the whole series of you know, films on the steel band, because standardization is something that has to be done very quickly in the movement.
First thing, we need a standardized pan. I will say it again, standardized pan. Tuners, pan tuners, come together. It's about time, fellas.
Pans should be standardized. So to speak, a pianist will leave from Russia and come to Trinidad. He don't have to work with a piano from Russia. He coming straight here in Trinidad and he jumping on the piano and he playing it. Pan men need to get that done.
All tuners have to get together with the executive body of Pan Shimigo or all pan men and decide what is what. What is simplest to play? What could be marketable?
Mr. Pan Maker, now is the time you must get together and decide of the styling you're using. So you must start right away for scandalizing, cause you can't keep on arguing forever on which telling that you have to do better, because the most important duty today you have on hand is to try and keep this band for Trinidadian. So you just tell me, how many grams of steel it will take to make a bass band? Or what is the degree of heat you need to burn a yellow band? Or what is the size of the rubber to be tied double tether? These are the facts that you must do.
Standardization could go for the schools and for bands that want to use it. And eventually that will fall into place because the schools would send out the young pans. You could start a standardized pan from the school, from the booth. These young children come up. Alright, that's alright, good. But tell them to pay attention to the type of metal and the gauge.
No, this is one instrument that is not easily user-tuned. So we have a market now for tuners. The more pans that are mass-produced, the more pans a tuner has to tune. In that sense, there'll be a lot of revenue coming in, not only to the country, but to the innovators and the tuners in the country as well. They may even be asked to go abroad and tune pans to schools, etc. So there's a big market open there for everybody in Trinidad.
Yeah, Curtis, if all I feel that this first film here is something else, wait till you see the next one. The next one we're doing is about the community, the pan yard, the spirit of the whole steel band movement, all of this.
Anyhow, after one practice, so...
Yeah, man!
You go pick up a little bit.
All right.
All right.